Omoyele, Sowore, good morning. Welcome to the morning show.
Thank you for bringing me back.
This is about your third time on this program.
We just had you a few months ago.
Yeah.
And you had your running mate with you.
No, it was his campaign manager.
Your campaign manager. Okay, that's right. All right, so but since then you have not, I don't know if you've released your manifesto so far?
We have, yes.
Okay, so can you tell us
what that... We have a manifesto, and our manifesto is defined as Spicer Heat, which is the 10 programs that we're bringing to Nigeria starting from next year that will solve a lot of the problems that you have been talking about on the show. It starts with security, followed by power, that's energy, and infrastructure, anti-corruption, an economy that is all-inclusive. We're doing restructuring, health, education, agriculture, and tourism. Spicer Heat.
Tourism.
Yes.
Okay. Are you focusing on them on that order?
And no, not in any particular order, but, you know, we are trying to be creative about it so that people can understand it at all levels. That's why, you know, we call it Spicer and then Heat, so that people can understand that we are heating up the system as to dissolve a lot of our problems.
When you look at these issues, they are not any different from what other candidates are pushing out. But you have repeatedly, you condemned the policy document of the All Progressives Congress, you condemned that of the PDP, but you're bringing up the same issues.
No, that's not true.
So what's different? For example,
in the area of power, we're the first to discuss using renewable energy as a means of providing supply of electricity 24/7. In Nigeria, and we set our programs are specific. As you know, the APC and the PDP, there's been an allegation that they even copied their manifesto from other people. We are the first to talk about a minimum wage that is specific, you know, that is bringing about a minimum wage that is legitimately a living wage in our view. And you saw that 3 days ago, South Africa stole that idea from us.
Okay.
And let's just hope they did in their own interest. And they increased their own minimum wage 30% across board. This is not just for federal workers in South Africa now, but everyone in South Africa who is in labor in the workforce is entitled to be paid an equivalent of 126,800 naira. That's equivalent to Nigerian naira. And that's become the law in South Africa. You cannot break that law. If you do it, it's a crime. But in Nigeria, we're still struggling to pay 30,000 naira per month. So what it does to us is that a professor that is earning 450,000 naira per month is going to take 2 years before they can earn the minimum wage of our senators, which is 13.7 million naira per month.
Well, I know it's fashionable to say South Africa has done this, Nigeria has not done the same thing, but fixing the minimum wage, is it not something you do relative to your national revenue profile?
It is.
Yeah, revenue but to your own circumstances.
Doc,
South Africa is Africa's most industrialized economy.
I really appreciate that you said that. But all of us in the media, you know, maybe excluding myself, celebrated when we said Nigerian economy is bigger than that of South Africa, so 3 years ago. That was when they recalibrated and rebased Nigerian economy. We celebrated it everywhere. We are now bigger than South Africa. So when it is time to say we are bigger than South Africa as an economy, we celebrate it. When we say do the responsibility of your size, we start saying that South Africa is bigger than us. No, it's not true. Our economy is $500 billion economy, GDP, right? Minimum wage that we are proposing is just $1.5 billion. Of that amount. That's what we intend to pay to workers. You know, but here is what we keep making as an argument. Let's stop deceiving ourselves. You cannot propel a Nigerian economy to the greatest height, not the next level, if you pay peanuts to your workers. You know, it makes them susceptible to corruption. It makes, you know, it kills their morale. And, you know, if you are in Osun State or your state, for example, you're sending your daughter or your son to school, to a university there, that is the Ladoke Akintola University of Technology, and you're asked to pay $250,000 as school fees. Where do you get the money from? So how come we don't talk about that? You know, the consequence of sending children to school, obtaining health, you know, and living a life that is at least comfortable. That is what minimum wage, that's why we are not talking about minimum wage, but a living wage for Nigeria. But let's even go beyond that and look at what our political office holders are receiving as, you know, emolument, salary, allowances. Unquestionable. So when it's time to talk about workers, we start applying economic, emotional arguments. We start saying South Africa is bigger than us. But when it comes to talking about our leaders, our political operators, and how much they earn and how much they make, nobody's talking about inflation. When a senator is taking home 14 million naira a month, which, by the way, is the minimum wage of a worker earning 18,000 naira over 37 years. So if you work for 38 years, I mean, between the day you start work at 18,000 naira and you retire, you are not going to receive enough money as a salary of, I mean, as the allowance of a senator who is taking home 14 million naira per month. That is per month. So let's be realistic about it. We have to stop, you know, serving the greedy. It's time to start, you know, applying
let's
our
talk
resources
about renewable
to
renewable energy.
Yes.
We had two gentlemen here yesterday
yes.
who came onto the program mm-hmm. to talk about renewable energy.
Yes.
And one of the things we observed, whether you are doing solar energy or you are doing wind energy or you are even using hydro,
yes.
that there is the issue of cost.
Yes.
There are many uncertainties.
Yes.
Whereas there is potential, you know, it's still a very gray area
yeah.
For Nigerians. So if you become president, it will it not be better for you to do more about the existing templates, you know, which the GenCos and DISCOs complain about, rather than say, oh, Nigeria will do renewable energy 100%.
No, we're not doing 100%. It's going to be a mix. We've always said that. We also have gas. You know, there are 9 billion cubic feet of gas in Ogoni land alone that can be tapped into to also generate electricity. But there is also potential for us to generate 4,500 megawatts of electricity out of northern Nigeria because of, you know, the preponderance of sunshine in that part of the world. There's also possibility for us to expand our hydroelectric generation capacity. There's possibility for biogas if we use the droppings of cows, if we go into commercial ranching, for instance, and we keep all our 20 million cows in ranches across the country, or not necessarily across the country, whatever we can afford to place them. The droppings alone can generate over 1,000 megawatts of electricity. We are just thinking progressively. It's not expensive. And what other thing we need to do is to break down this behemoth called the national grid. It's obsolete, it's no longer working for us, and have isolated mini-grids across the country. So if you are generating from Kano, you supply Kano first. And everybody can also get into the business of selling electricity. Electricity that comes from, say, solar, don't have to come from government alone. You can have your roof plastered with solar energy panels, and you can sell into to a GenCo, for example, or a DISCO, whichever way they are described. But currently, our system has broken down in terms of electricity. There's no way we can continue with this miserable 3,000 megawatts of electricity that the GenCos and DISCOs are managing. And there's no way we can continue with our broken transmission system that is not taking us anywhere. So I don't even want to discuss what we have currently. It's not sufficient, it's not going to serve the purpose we need, and we cannot use that to create a new economy that we are talking about that will generate over 5 million jobs, okay. that we'll be talking about, that will bring about prosperity in this country, and that will make us competitive even in the African sub-region. Or the sub-Saharan African region. So let's talk about Morocco, for example. Morocco is about selling electricity to Malta and France. Right? The same thing is happening in Tunisia. Egypt just increased their electricity generation to 17,000. Over 2.5 years, 17,000 megawatts. So what is wrong with us here is because we don't have leaders who understand how these things work. They have become obsolete in their thinking. They don't know how to operate things. And beyond that, corruption has destroyed this country to the point that we once spent $16 billion to generate electricity. Well, not generate electricity, but darkness. That is what happened with the PDP in the last 16 years. So I'm not discussing that. We're discussing things that are possible in the future, and that's why we're here.
Okay, so
what kind of security architecture do you have in mind? Because most of your comments on security, it's either I've heard you say, oh, all the service chiefs should be fired.
Absolutely.
And all of that. Yes. You know, is it really about personnel
or about the
framework, the architecture itself?
No, it's personnel, it's leadership as well. So two things are happening in Nigeria. We're spending too much of our time using soldiers to carry back for madams. You know, that's how to break it down in a simple way. We need our police.
Soldiers?
Yes. Soldiers are doing...
Carrying bags?
Yeah, they're going. They are carrying bags.
No, I haven't seen that.
I don't think I've seen that either.
You should read Sahara Reporters more. I'm not promoting it. But we have photographs of soldiers, policemen carrying bags for...
Yeah, I know about policemen. Yeah,
soldiers are doing it too. Soldiers are doing jobs that they are not supposed to do. They are supposed to focus and concentrate on protecting the territorial integrity of Nigeria. While we strengthen our police to do internal security, we now even have the Civil Defense Force carrying arms, so there should be enough so that our soldiers can concentrate fully on fighting the terrorists. The reason I said I'm going to fire army generals is that, you know, Boko Haram has become an industrial complex. People are making money off of it.
How so?
Oh, yes. You know, I covered Boko Haram for over, since it started. And I knew that if they wanted to end Boko Haram, it would have ended by now. There was even a BBC report, which is not from a Nigerian newspaper, that said Shekau, who was leader of one of the factions, was almost getting killed. And they got a call from Abuja to stand down the special unit that was fighting on Boko Haram at that time. In terms of personnel, the Nigerian army don't have enough commanders. There are only 5,000 commanders commanding over 300,000 soldiers. Because the senior army officers in the country don't want the promotion to happen to people below them. So to keep themselves in their permanent positions where they make a lot of money and make, you know, deals, they keep just a few officers. And as a result, people are exposed to danger. They're getting killed. I think I was on a show about a month ago where I said that our soldiers are just being led to slaughter. And some, you know, the moment I got out of the show, the APC people on Twitter started condemning what I said. Mm-hmm. Then a few weeks later, look at what happened to our soldiers. You know, these guys have been exposed. There's nowhere in the world where you are fighting the kind of insurgency we're fighting, and you put people in open vans inside deserts to be roaming around. It's like leading people to their slaughter. In other countries, in Sena times, what do? You put them in armored personnel carriers. What happened to them? The soldiers themselves are making, you know, videos saying that they are using T-72 tanks that were bought in 1983. Are we living in the past? Listen, what I'll say that's most important, though, is that apart from just recalibrating and reordering the leadership of the military, we have to fire the commander-in-chief of the armed forces, the one that is there now.
Okay,
President
but
Buhari.
Tell us how, in specific terms, the, people are making money out of Boko Haram.
Oh, you
I
know,
mean, you just made a statement. You
yes,
have to actually
so,
clarify it.
Thank you very much. So, you know, I used to be an investigative reporter before I came to this, and I did most of the investigative reports that led to the arrest of several military officers. The Navy, the Air Force, when Buhari came into office. And then they set up their own investigation in the government. And the moment that investigation was going in the direction of some of their serving political office holders or army generals, they shut it down. I mentioned at that time that Dambazo was indicted, but they didn't allow the indictment to take place because he was a member of the party. Even the current chief of army staff, we had reports showing that he had homes in Dubai that he bought when he was part of the procurement of military hardware. This evidence was presented. They were making payments to the bank for the homes in Dubai. An army colonel was being sent to the bank to pay regularly to First Group, which was later quietly shut down. That's the prop. You usually, if you go to Abuja hotels, the big hotel, you find a group called First Group. They, you know, they stand around in the lobby asking you to buy houses in Dubai. Sometimes it's not full properties. You know, it's to buy a fraction of properties in Dubai. You know, they eventually shut them down quietly so that they cover up all of this. They continued with that. These are not something that happened in the past. These are things that continued into this current government.
Sure, right, about
and
a week ago.
I wanted to say finally, also, not finally, but one of it is how they do deals with some of the girls that were rescued. You need to know the amount of money that were involved in the deals. Well, it was about 5 million euros at the time before it set. As a matter of fact, we heard at that time, part of our investigation, that Boko Haram wanted to release all the girls at once. But they told them to hold on because this is business for us. Let's be doing it gradually. When they went and took girls from Dapchi, they got a lot of money too. So it got to a point that you're wondering, why is it that they just don't allow Boko Haram to have an embassy in Abuja so that we know that they are legitimately a government controlling part of our territory.
Okay, let's talk a bit about your campaign.
Yes.
About a week ago, you started this 100-city tour.
Yes.
I don't know whether you can cover 100 cities within the short time you have left before the election. But you went to Daura.
Yes.
The home of the
President
Buhari. Yes. What did you see there? How was the reception?
It was amazing.
I had some of them were calling you
Sebobo.
Sebobo.
So when we were actually on our way to Katsina, which is the capital of Katsina State, his home state, and we got to Daura, and it was night. So we were hoping that we can just pass through the place, only to find out that people were waiting for us, you know. And we followed them, and we were shocked. First, we were shocked that the place was dark, no electricity. In Buhari's hometown, and then
why should there be electricity there when there is no electricity in other parts of Nigeria?
Well, we found that to be surprising because we had thought that as president of Nigeria, at least you know, as they say, charity begins at home. You know, if they are showcasing that they have achieved a few things, including improvement in electricity, you would like to see it in the home of the president. He doesn't live in a jungle. But let's move on. And we got there, only to find a lot of young people saying, man, we love you to, why did you come in the night? We'd have loved to take you around. In fact, they promised to take us to the front of his house to remind him that he's coming back home. They don't want him to continue as president of Nigeria. And then we went around, and it turns out that the people of Daura are complaining about Buhari as much as the people of Abonema in Port Harcourt or elsewhere that you can go in Nigeria. They are tired of President Buhari. In fact, I don't know if they want him to come back home, because for a lot of them, it was a disgrace. One of the kids was sent to us on tape that Buhari is finished. Buhari is finished. That was in his hometown. We were surprised at the reception, because typically we thought maybe there could be some hostility and it was night. It wasn't so. And this was live. We taped it live as we were rolling through the town. And as we approached the exit of the town, these kids follow us, I mean, young people mostly. And that was how they started the Say Bobo thing, which is an opposite of Say Baba, you know. I think they are tired of all the Babas, and they are asking that, you know, we continue the life of the country on the back of a young white person.
Let me ask you two real questions. Yeah. One, taking you back to security. Josh yesterday described the Nigerian police force as an occupation force for the ruling All Progressives Congress.
Yeah.
Are you worried that the police is not neutral going into this election? That's my first question to you.
Yes.
Secondly, let me ask you about funding of election campaigns in Nigeria. We've heard presidential candidates on this show saying that they feel disadvantaged already because they do not have the resources the major parties have.
Mm-hmm.
However, they say they don't need so much funds to pass their message to Nigerians.
Yeah.
You are doing a crowdfunding for $2 million.
Yes.
What happens if you don't reach that mark? Would you resort to those you so much reprove as godfathers?
Yeah. So the first question about the police, I was quite appalled at what the police did yesterday. To the Adeyanju, who was protesting against police seeming lack of neutrality in the election. And when I read the press release of the police, I found out that they're charging Deji for, you know, all kinds of very nebulous crimes. I couldn't believe it. In fact, they said at the end of their press release that they presented evidence of, you know, what I thought would be weapons. And it turns out there were Facebook posts and, you know, posters to say that, you know, the police should be neutral. It's very, very despicable that a Nigerian police got to that. And you could tell that they have found themselves in a defensive state, because since yesterday, they have been issuing releases to defend why they did this ridiculous thing. I was a student activist in the 90s, and even in the 90s, this would be ridiculous under military rule that police will arrest somebody for protesting,
you know, expressing
an opinion. And I do that all the time. And what you are saying is that they are just using Deji, Adeyanju, and the rest of them as social experimentation for what they will do to candidates that are critical of the government or even political interests or parties. So we must all condemn this, and it should not be allowed. This is, they are stepped over their bounds, and we must condemn it. I'll go to crowdfunding, which is what we're doing. We've reached 100,000 dollars. now out of $2 million that we said we want or we want to raise. And this is a way of getting Nigerians to own the electoral process or the campaign process, because otherwise politicians just save money in bags and distribute to people. They save Ankara, distribute to people. They distribute rice that are branded. But in this case, we're getting people interested and excited and energized to say, look, you know, if you put your money in the political process, you support the candidate, you're likely to be more interested in what happens to this candidate and how they're running their campaign. And it brings about political participation at a level that you've never seen before. So, but in order to save ourselves the embarrassment of running short of the money we need, we also open a Nigerian account, a Zenith Bank account, where we raised over 35 million naira almost now. People are donating.
Wow.
Yes.
That's interesting.
Yes. So we are close to 100 million naira. We're about 72 million naira now. And people are making donations. And every night, we also announce for people who want their names to be announced how much they've donated transparently.
That the EFCC is saying that, look, all of these monies, contributions, should be reported to the last detail.
Yes.
And the spending, the disbursement should be reported. Yes. I hope you are keeping records.
We keep records. But we hope that the EFCC is also tracking records of the spending by the APC. We heard the other day that the Kano State Governor, Gandola, also contributed.
Is it
Gandola. I just came from Kano. They've changed his name to Gandola.
Oh,
because of the way he was collecting dollars in his Bamariga. So they call him Gandola.
In case
you haven't heard about it, that's his new nickname, Gandola. So he donated 10 million naira to the EFCC. Although the EFCC denied it, but they haven't denied it convincingly. Yes, in a way. But we have also found governors who use state resources to donate buses to the Buhari campaign, and all these buses are available. We don't have to worry about it, but we are just saying that those who are, you know, coming to equity. Must come with clean hands. And that applies also to the People's Democratic Party. They must explain in details how they got the money in Port Harcourt to bribe all the delegates that voted for Atiku. So we hope everybody is keeping records, and EFCC will do a great job of making sure that they're impartial so that they don't turn themselves into the Nigerian police with their despicable acts of yesterday.
Although you really didn't answer my question, I said if you run short of the money you need, where are you going?
So running short of money is not the same thing as running short of support. And the way to break it down is that apart from the cash, people are also making kind donations. They are donating apartments, cars for branding for us. People are taking over. We have a process where individuals can also support ward chairmen, campaigners, and people who are canvassers directly without getting through us. We had someone, for example, who donated over 15 megaphones to us from New York. We just brought them yesterday. And these are ways through which you can support. But we hope that more Nigerians will come out, because we need about 400 million naira more.
And you have about 100 million now?
No, at this point, 73 million naira has been raised creatively. And this has been done transparently as well. So ESCC can also go to our Facebook, our GoFundMe account page.
And also contribute.
They can. Perhaps we don't need ESCC's contribution at this point, since they themselves are taking contribution.
Yes.
If ESCC contributes to my campaign, you know, I'll be entitled to it since they started.
Right.
I think Sahara reporters have supported ESCC the most. So, but we won't take it as an institution. If their members, their respective officers, okay, that's want to contribute, they are free to do so from their salary.
I'm sure they are listening to you.
Yeah, I'm sure. And they're not far from here.
Anyway, thank you very much. What's that your new name?
Sebobo.
Yes.
Yes.
It's thank always
you.
A pleasure to have you here.
Thank you so
for joining.
Much.
Thanks for being here. Yes. It's time now for a short break on the morning show.